बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम। आई एम मोहम्मद अबू बकर एंड इन दिस वीडियो वी शैल बी सॉल्विंग द कैम्ब्रिज इंटरनेशनल एजुकेशन बायोलॉजी द फर्स्ट पेपर ऑफ 2022 मई जून, क्वेश्चन पेपर 11, पेपर 1 मल्टीपल चॉइस क्वेश्चंस ओनली। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट आवर वीडियो। द डायग्राम शोज अ प्लांट सेल। सो दिस इज अ प्लांट सेल। द सेल इज स्टेन्ड विद एन आयोडीन सोल्यूशन। सो After staining with iodine solution, what are the colors of the cell wall and the starch grain? So, the cell wall is made of cellulose. The cell wall is made of cellulose, whereas starch grain consists of glucose molecules, or it is simply starch. So, starch grain will give a blue-black color, as same as glucose does, whereas the cellulose will give an orange brown color. So C is your right answer. He has not asked us here to check the color of the nucleus, so nucleus is just being put here as an symbol, but it is not needed. Only cell wall and starch grain will give colors with the iodine solution. Cell wall made of cellulose will give an orange brown color, whereas starch grain will give a blue black color like a glucose molecule, a glucose substance does. So C is your right option. The diagram shows a shape of a RBC. What is an advantage of this shape? Allows it to carry more hemoglobin. No, the carrying of hemoglobin does not depend on this shape. Allows it to move more quickly in arteries. No, again, increases its surface area for diffusion. Yes, this is true. This is a RBC which is nearly circular. It has higher surface area, and higher surface area means greater will be the rate at which it allows oxygen to come in, and greater is the amount of oxygen absorbed by the hemoglobin on this RBC. So yes, C. And advantage of this shape is that this shape increases the surface area for diffusion, prevents it getting trapped in walls, in vein. No, this is again not an advantage of this shape. So C is the right option. The diagram shows four plant cells. They all are carrying out aerobic respiration. Which diagram represents the movement of carbon dioxide molecules? So, when does the carbon dioxide move out of the molecules? When the amount of carbon dioxide in the cell is itself greater, and in the atmosphere it is lower, and carbon dioxide moves out of the cells during aerobic respiration, not during photosynthesis. During respiration, the glucose molecule reacts with oxygen to give CO2 and water, and CO2 is higher in amount within the cell and is lower in amount in the atmosphere. So it has to move out. So it doesn't move in the cell as shown in A, and it moves out of the cell. Out of the cell, it is lower in concentration, yes, and it is higher in concentration in the cell. So D is your right answer. The rate of respiration and the rate of nitrate ion absorption by a root hair cell was measured at different soil nitrate concentration. At X, the concentration of nitrate in the soil is the same as in the cell. Which graph shows how the rate of absorption varies with nitrate concentration in the soil? So we have, first of all, we should know that nitrate ions are absorbed by active transport, first of all. But when they are only absorbed by active transport when there is not enough amount of nitrate ions, amount of nitrate NO3 negative ions in soil. Now, as you can see in graph, in all of these graphs, as the nitrate concentration in the soil increases, means the rate of this and rate of nitrate absorption should also increase. And at X, the concentration of nitrate in the soil is same as in the cell. So, is same as in the cell. Now, in graph C, we clearly can see that this line nitrate concentration in the soil has not a point X like this. This line does not have X on it. So, C is incorrect. First of all, similarly, D again doesn't have this point X. If D was a line like this, then this would have been true. But this is again incorrect, because this D line, this straight line, has not any point like X as shown. So, D is also incorrect. In B, we can see that as the nitrate ion concentration becomes equal to the rate of nitrate absorption, then the amount of nitrate absorption becomes constant. But it does not actually happens here. What actually happens here, that when the amount of nitrate ion absorption and the nitrate concentration in the soil become constant, the plant would still like to absorb more nitrate. It would absorb more nitrate. But when there is more than sufficient, when there is highly sufficient nitrate in the plant cell, then the rate of absorption of nitrates would become constant K, as shown in graph A. So, A is your right answer. Question number 5. The graph shows how the rate of reaction of a protease from the stomach varies with the pH. So show the rate of reaction of a protease from a stomach varies with the pH. Okay, so this graph shows the rate of reaction of protease against the pH. So what describes the pH at point X? So this is the point X. So the highest pH at which this enzyme is active, this is even higher. This point is even higher at which this enzyme is still active. So A is incorrect. The lowest pH that does not destroy the enzyme, this is again a false statement. The pH at which the substrate starts to run out, this is not a graph of substrate activity. So C, A, B, C are incorrect. So by the method of elimination, we know that D is true. And why D is true? Because X symbolizes the pH that produces the highest rate of enzyme activity. So what is X? X is the optimum pH at which this enzyme protease works. Is the optimum pH for this enzyme protease. So D is your right answer. A dilute starch solution turns blue when very dilute iodine solution is added. This color disappears as the starch is broken down by amylase. The graph shows the disappearance of the blue color at different temperatures. So the temperature is on the x-axis. The time for blue color to disappear is on the y-axis. Which statement explains the shape of the curve? Now, this y-axis, he has said that dilute starch solution turns blue for when dilute iodine is added. This color disappears as the starch is broken down by amylase. So this statement on the y means the rate of reaction simply. This is the rate of reaction of amylase with the starch. This is the rate of reaction and this of this amylase. And this graph now this graph means that it means that how the rate of reaction of amylase varies with the temperature. So this graph is about the enzyme activity of amylase at different temperatures. So that's what we have to figure out. This statement explains the curve of the shape of the curve. When the temperature is zero, there is not any reaction. As the temperature increases, the reaction increases. And when the temperature reaches 36 or 37, 35, 36, that it is the optimum temperature, it is the optimum K, optimum Kelvin temperature, and after the temperature increases, and when the temperature increases beyond 36-37, then the time, then the rate of reaction for amylase with starch again starts to decrease, as shown in this graph. So enzyme activity rises as the temperature rises. Yes, it does rise, but up to a specific value of optimum temperature. As the temperature goes beyond that, the rate of enzyme activity falls. So A is incorrect. Enzymes have an optimum range for activity. Yes, enzymes have an optimum range for activity, like as in this graph, the amylase have 35 to 36.5 or 37, something like that. So B is true. Enzymes are inactive below 30 degrees C. No, they are active below 30 degrees C, but their rate of activity is lower. Enzymes do not work above 30 degrees C. No, they again work above 30 degrees C temperature. So B is your right option. A plant has leaves with both green and white areas. One of its leaves is partly covered with aluminium foil, which blocks light. So this is the green area, this shaded area, this white area is the, this is the white area, this is the aluminium foil, and this is the white area. He has already shown that. The plant is then placed under a lamp for 24 hours. After this time, discs are cut from the areas of the leaf and tested with the iodine solution. Which leaf discs will give a blue-black color when tested with iodine solution? So when does an iodine solution give blue-black color? When we react it with either glucose or starch. We know this. Now starch is not directly produced within this leaf, so glucose should be manufactured, and if glucose is produced, then iodine will give blue-black color. And so when is glucose produced? During photosynthesis. Yes, when 6 CO2 molecules combine with 6 oxygen in the presence of sunlight. So sunlight is an essential in the presence of chlorophyll. It gives glucose and oxygen. Now he has asked us which discs give a blue-black color. Means which pieces among these have produced glucose. Now as you can see in W and Z, they both are like in this positions. Now the sunlight is being blocked, has been blocked for them. Now they have not obtained sunlight, means that they have failed to carry out respiration. So Z will fail to carry out respiration. So Z is incorrect. And also Y has failed to carry out respiration, because Y already is at such a position on which the area of the green is white, means that this area of the leaf does not contains chlorophyll. So chlorophyll is absent for W and X. The chlorophyll is absent for W and X. The chlorophyll is absent. So they would not carry out photosynthesis. They would not carry out photosynthesis because the chlorophyll is absent. Whereas for Z and Y, the Z has not been allowed to get the light energy, so Z will not carry out photosynthesis and would not produce glucose. Only Y is left, which will carry out photosynthesis in the presence of sunlight, in the presence of chlorophyll, to give glucose, which will yield a blue black color when tested with an iodine solution. So D is your right answer here. A gardener grows tomato plants in pots. To begin with, the plants produce green leaves and grow quickly. Then after a few weeks, the leaves turn yellow. Which type of water can the gardener use on the plants to make the leaves turn green again? Now the leaves have wilted here, the leaves have turned yellow. And why the leaves have turned yellow? Because the chlorophyll has lost its own color. The chlorophyll has lost its color. And why has chlorophyll lost its color? It is mainly due to deficiency of magnesium ions. So a fertilizer with a water with fertilizer containing magnesium will definitely help. So A is your right answer. Whereas distilled water will not help, rain water will not help. Water with fertilizer containing nitrate only helps in growth, does not help the chlorophyll to reconstitute. So A is your right answer. Which row shows the disease caused by a deficiency of different nutrients in the diet? So the lack of iron always causes anemia. Remember this, lack of vitamin C causes scurvy. Lack of vitamin C causes scurvy, whereas the lack of vitamin D causes rickets, in which the calcium and phosphorus are not adequately absorbed in the bones. So D is your right answer. Four food tests were carried out on four different white powders A, B, C, D. The results are shown in the table. Which powder contains a carbohydrate, so a fat and a protein? Now, first of all, for carbohydrates are glucose and starch, mainly glucose, a carbohydrate. So a carbohydrate always gives a blue-black color with an iodine solution. We know this. Whereas a protein gives a blue color with the Benedict's test, whereas a fat gives a milky color with the ethanol emulsion test. So A is your right answer. A protein does not give an orange color with Benedict solution, so B is incorrect. For Burette test, I'm not sure for Burette test, but I know that a Benedict test gives blue color with the protein. So A is your right answer. What is an example of assimilation? So first of all, we should get to know what assimilation actually is. Assimilation, I think we can call assimilation the conversion. I'm not sure about assimilation, but assimilation can be called as the conversion, or you can say incorporation of absorbed simple food into complex substances which are actually constituting the body. So absorption of glycerol into the lacteals is not a type of assimilation. Breakdown of glycogen into glucose is converse to assimilation. It is the breakdown, it is not assimilation. Building of proteins from amino acids, manufacturing of complex substances, proteins from simple substances, amino acids, C is assimilation. Release of hormone from a gland is not a type of assimilation, it is just a secretion. So C is your right answer. Four plant shoots were set up as shown in the diagram in the same environmental conditions. Waterproof petroleum jelly was applied to the plant surfaces as shown. So waterproof jelly, so petroleum jelly of the lower leaf surface, on the upper leaf surface, on the both leaf surface, and no petroleum jelly in the plant. Four. Each beaker with its plant shoot and water was weighed at the start of the experiment and after 24 hours. After 24 hours, the percentage loss in the mass was calculated for each plant shoot. Now, which row shows the results of this experiment? So, this is the layer of the oil to stop the evaporation of water. Now, the plant will not be able to carry out photosynthesis because water is absent, first of all. Now, once the water is absent, then glucose will break down in respiration to produce CO2 and water. And as the glucose is broken down, that's when the mass of the plant starts to fall. Now we have been asked to calculate the number of the percentage loss in mass after 24 hours in all these four plants. The plant one has petroleum jelly on lower leaf surfaces. Now it has only on the lower leaf surfaces, means that it will not be able to properly expel carbon dioxide. It will not be able to expel CO2 and it will not be able to expel CO2 properly. So the greatest, the lowest mass would be 5 or 3 for the plant one. It would not be greatest. It would not be it would not be greatest. For plant 2, it has the same conditions as the plant when plant 1, but it has petroleum jelly on the upper leaf surface. So I think it will have greater than plant 1, because it is only on the upper leaf surfaces which have lower stomata, whereas plant 1 will have lower. Plant 3 has petroleum jelly on upper and lower surfaces both, means that it has no means to expel carbon dioxide or to inhale carbon dioxide, means no photosynthesis, the greatest loss of mass. So plant 3 will have the greatest loss of mass, actually not plant 1. Plant 1 will have greater than 3 but lower than plant 2, whereas in plant 4 there is not any petroleum jelly. So there would be the lowest loss in mass after 24 hours. Lowest loss in mass is in plant 4, it is 15. So B is your right option. This is very tricky MCQ, an A star MCQ. If I revise the concepts here applied again, the concepts applied here again, these we have been asked to calculate the percentage loss in mass after the 24 hours when these four plants 1, 2, 3, 4 are placed in different four beakers, given the conditions that there is a layer of oil on the top to stop evaporation, and some of these plants have been covered with petroleum jelly so that CO2 doesn't come in or doesn't go out. Now, why will loss in mass happen? Because first of all, the plant would not be able to carry out photosynthesis because it is not able to absorb water, and then glucose will be disintegrated to CO2 and water, and CO2 would not be expelled, means the plant will completely be destroyed. The plant will not be able to carry out any kind of respiration or photosynthesis. So the lowest loss in mass after 24 hours would be in plant 4, which has no petroleum jelly. It will then be in plant 2, which has petroleum jelly on upper leaf surfaces, because it allows some of the CO2 to pass out. The plant 3 would be at the lowest because it has on both the upper and the lower leaf surfaces, and plant 1 would have the second lowest because it has petroleum jelly on the lower leaf surfaces. So B is your right answer. So question number 13, what is the main cause of water moving up to the leaves in the xylem vessels? Now, movement of water up the xylem vessels is because of the evaporation from the leaf. So active transport, no. Evaporation from the epidermis of the leaf, no. Evaporation happens from the walls of the mesophyll cell, C is better than B. Use of water in photosynthesis, no again. So C is your right answer. Which blood vessels carry blood towards the heart and towards the lungs? So towards the heart, blood vessels which carry blood towards the heart. So aorta carries blood away from the heart, so aorta is incorrect. The vena cava will definitely carry blood towards the heart, whereas towards the lungs is the pulmonary artery, which contains deoxygenated blood, so the blood goes for oxidation. So B is your right option. The pulmonary vein brings blood back from the lungs towards the heart. So B is your right option. The diagram shows the right side of the human heart when the ventricle is relaxed. The ventricle is when relaxed. Which row describes the position of valve X and valve Y when the ventricle contracts? Now the valve X would definitely be closed when this ventricle contracts, so it allows the blood to flow towards the heart. So valve X would definitely be closed here, whereas some of you might choose valve Y to be closed here, but it is not. It is open here because both the ventricles contract simultaneously, so the blood flows through the Y in this direction and through the towards the lungs. So valve Y would be open and valve X would be closed. So B is your right option. People who have a diet that contains a lot of fat and who smoke have two important risk factors for which disease? First of all, they have a lot of lipid content in their food and they smoke. So it is not anemia. Anemia is because of iron deficiency. Coronary heart disease is possible. Emphysema is possible only because of smoke. Scurvy is possible because of vitamin C deficiency. So we are only left with B, and B makes most sense. So B is your right option. Which equation represents aerobic respiration in plant cells? The aerobic respiration in which the glucose molecule combines with the oxygen to produce CO2 and water. So D is correct. C is the fermentation reaction. B is again, this is a completely wrong reaction. And A is photosynthesis. So D is your right option. Four flasks are sterilized and set up as shown. Which flasks will show signs of fermentation and aerobic respiration after 1 hour? Now these are four flasks. First of all, we will differentiate because of temperature. A and C are incorrect because the temperature is too low for fermentation to be carried out. Whereas among B and D, some of you might choose B, some of you might choose D. But why will one choose D instead of B? That's because D contains sugar. If the dried yeast and water are added to sugar, these both are completely different experiments. No change will occur, but in B, this dried yeast will start its activity on this sugar and will start to ferment this sugar into different products like ethanol, acetaldehyde, CO2. So CO2 is here to absorb the CO2 is being absorbed in D or sorry CO2 is escaped here. So I would go with D because D contains sugar, which is the primary constituent why the yeast is added. So D is your right option. Which row shows actions that occur when humans breathe in? So when humans breathe in, now check yourself, and once you breathe out, now I know that my diaphragm has become dome shaped. So when I breathe in, it will definitely flatten. And when I breathe out, my external intercostal muscles relax. When I breathe in, they contract, and when I breathe out, my ribs fall, and when I breathe in, my ribs rise. So C is true. When the diaphragm flattens, the ribs rises. When the rib falls, the diaphragm rises. So C is your right option. Which graph shows the change in concentration of glucose of molecules in the dialysis fluid during kidney dialysis? So during kidney dialysis, this is the key. This dotted line represents urea and the straight line is glucose. Now if I check, the concentration is on the y-axis and time of dialysis is on the x. Now the concentration of glucose will remain constant because glucose is not an harmful substance. A and D are definitely incorrect. Whereas the now some of you might choose the C as true because the concentration of urea falls, but he has asked us to change in the concentration in the dialysis fluid, not in the blood. C is true for blood, whereas B is true for the dialysis fluid. In the dialysis fluid, the concentration of urea rises with time as shown here, where the glucose remains same, K constant. So B is your right option here. The diagram shows some structures in a human skin. Which row shows the name of the structures X, Y and Z? Y here is the hair follicle. Obviously, it is not a blood vessel. Now, to differentiate between X and Z, I will see that this X has this narrow tube which opens to the outside, means it is something that it releases to the outside. Now it will not be a blood vessel because blood is never released to the outside. It is not blood vessel, it is not a hair follicle, so it is definitely a sweat gland. And I am only left with Z, which appears to be a network of capillaries, a blood vessel. So C is your right option. Sometimes you might have to try the method of elimination as well. Sometimes you might apply direct knowledge, your theory. The graph shows changes in the person's body temperature plotted against time. So what could cause the changes in body temperature in period 1 and 2? So body temperature increases to 39 or 38 degrees C during period 1 and then it starts to fall. So what could be the possible changes in periods 1 and 2 in the temperatures, body temperatures? In the period 1, there is reduced air temperature. No, if there is reduced air temperature, then the temperature should have been something like this. If there was reduced air temperature, it is vigorous exercise which causes an increase in body temperature. So yes, C and D can be right. Whereas to bring this 38.5 degree temperature to back to the normal value, the body will carry out increased sweating to carry out evaporation so that the body loses its internal energy. So I will go with C. It would not carry out shivering to retain energy, it will carry out sweating to lose energy. So C is your right option. The diagram shows a cross section of the human brain. If structure X is damaged, which body functions may be affected? So structure X is the cerebellum, which is responsible for the movement, posture and balance, definitely mostly. So D is your right answer. Control of body temperature is in the control of hypothalamus, control of breathing and heartbeat. It is in the control of, the medulla oblongata. Whereas the control of emotion, language, memory, reasoning is in the control of amygdala. It is in the control of amygdala of the forebrain. Amygdala. You will study it in FSC in A levels. So C, so D is your right option. So question number 24. Which diagram shows how light from a distant object is focused on the retina to form a clear image? So light comes from a distant object, focused on the retina, and a clear image is formed. So for a clear image, it should definitely be either A or B as true answers, not C and D. In C and D, blur or incorrect images are being formed. Whereas it is a distant object, you can clearly see. So the light rays are coming from a greater distance as shown in A. In B, the light rays are coming from some object which is placed at this point. So A is true. A is your right option. The graph shows the changing blood glucose concentration in one person over 24 hours. Which statement explains the shape of the graph? So this key shows that meal is eaten here. At these points, the meal is eaten. So what we can infer from this graph, after each meal, adrenaline is released. No, adrenaline is not released after each meal. After each meal, insulin is reached, is released. So when the meal is eaten here, the blood glucose concentration increases. It increases, and then secretion of insulin in the blood decreases the blood glucose concentration. And again, the blood glucose concentration after the meal, again, it decreases after the secretion of insulin here. So after each meal, insulin is released. Before each meal, adrenaline is released. No, adrenaline is not released. Before each meal, insulin is released. It is released after each meal. So B is your right option. What happens when the triceps muscles of the forelimb begins to contract? So when the triceps muscles begin to contract, the biceps muscle begin to relax. Yes, this follows the law of, follows the principle of antagonistic action of the muscles. So A is true. It starts to pull the radius bone upwards. No, it doesn't pull upwards. The arm becomes bent at the elbow joint. Arm becomes bent. No, it flattens. The upper arm is raised above the shoulder. This is again incorrect. A is your right option. A patient has a bacterial infection. A sample of the bacteria is taken to identify which antibiotic is which antibiotic to be used for this patient. The sample from the patient is spread evenly on an agar plate. Small paper discs soaked in each of the four antibiotics are placed on the agar plate, which is kept warm overnight. So, small four paper discs, which are soaked in different four antibiotics, are then placed. The diagram shows the results of the test. The shaded area shows where the bacteria have grown. Which antibiotic is most effective against these bacteria? So, the shaded area have shown, shaded areas shows where the bacteria have grown. So I can see that in all this area, which is not white, the bacteria has grown here. So whereas in A, D, B, C, the bacteria has not grown. So which of these four is most effective against the bacteria means in this, which has the greatest potency to reduce the growth of bacteria. In A is true. Why A is true? Because A region does not allow the bacteria to grow. This region in which the antibiotic A is put does not allow the bacteria to grow. D has smaller comparatively to A, B has even smaller, and C has the lowest, has the smallest, sorry. So true is A. Why A is true? Because A is put, because A has shown its results on a greater area in which the bacteria doesn't grow, in which it is not shedded. So A is your right option. Which row shows some structures of the structures found in bacteria, fungi, and the viruses? The cell membrane is present in both bacteria, fungi, but it is never present in viruses. Cell wall is present is absent in bacteria. It is present in fungi. It is present in viruses. No, it is not present in viruses. So 2 is incorrect. Nucleus is present in fungi as well. So whereas it is absent in viruses, so 3 is incorrect. Protein coat is only a characteristic of the viruses. So 1 and 4 are true, means D is the right option. Question number 29. The graph shows the mass of penicillium grown in a fermenter and the mass of the antibiotic produced. When is the penicillium producing antibiotic most rapidly? So these are the catchwords of this statement here. Most rapidly means the time during. So first of all, I will explain the graph. So the mass of the penicillium and the antibiotic is shown. The mass of the antibiotic rises from 1.5 day, starts to increase, and then it increases the most on the 5th to 6th day, and then it starts to again become again increase, but slowly, as it was during the day 4, 5, and 6. Now, when is the penicillium producing antibiotic most rapidly? When the mass is rising, when the mass is rising most rapidly, when the mass is rising most rapidly, it is rising most rapidly here. It is, let me change the color, it is rising most rapidly here at this point. Although it is due rising here, but the greatest rise is, the greatest slope is during the 4th, 5th, and 5.5 day. So this period has the greatest rise. So I had said that during the day 5, there was the greatest production of penicillium, greatest production of antibiotic by the penicillium. So C is true, C is your right answer. The diagram shows the nitrogen cycle. Now, so this is the nitrogen cycle complete diagram. In which stages of the nitrogen cycle are the nitrogen fixing bacteria important? So the nitrogen in atmosphere is absorbed by the root nodules of legumes, which is converted into amino acid and protein in plants in particularly. So in the root nodules of legumes, they contain the rhizopus species, which are the nitrogen fixing bacteria, and they fix nitrogen for plants. So 2 has great importance for the plants. Whereas the bacteria living in the soil convert nitrogen from the air to ammonium nitrate, to the ammonium ions in the soil, and then the soil convert these into ammonium ions, and then these are absorbed by the plants once again. So 3 has again great importance. 4 is the ammonifying bacteria or the deammonifying bacteria. So 4 has no importance as a nitrogen fixing bacteria. 5 is the ammonium into nitrates. So 5 has again, this is the ammonifying, nitrifying bacteria here. This is the nitrifying bacteria. So it is again no importance, and nitrates are converted back into nitrogen in the atmosphere. So it is denitrifying bacteria in 1. So only 2 and 3 are the stages where there is the greatest demand of nitrogen fixing bacteria. So 2 and 3 means what? B is our right answer. Malaria is spread by 1, which acts as a dash for this disease, 2 for this disease. Which terms correctly describe the sentence? So 1 is the mosquito, it is not a bacterium, and it serves as a vector. The Aedes aegypti serves as a vector. What increases in the long term as a result of tropical deforestation? Cloud cover, no. Humidity, no. Soil erosion increases in long term. There is a great long term soil erosion, which again has later on devastating effects. So C is true, soil fertility, no, it decreases. The diagram shows a section through a bean seed, which labeled part is the testa. What is testa? It is surrounding the ovule. Which is surrounding the seed, which is initially present around the ovule. So D is the testa. Which row shows the 2 hormones that are necessary for ovulation to occur? So hormones necessary for ovulation to occur are always the enzymes which have this H, which are abbreviated. So remember this: the follicle stimulating hormone, the luteinizing hormone, they are important. Whereas estrogen and progesterone are not necessary. So D is true, D is your right answer. The diagram shows the female reproductive system. Where does the fertilization takes place? The fertilization doesn't take place in the ovaries, doesn't take place in the cervix, doesn't take place in the uterus. It takes place in the fallopian tubes. The fallopian tubes. So B is true. B symbolizes the fallopian tubes. So B is your right answer. The diagram shows a developing fetus in the uterus. What is the liquid at X called? Blood. It is not the blood. It is not the urine. It is not the water. It is the amniotic fluid, which has all the waste and all the nutrients that this baby boy, the baby, this fetus needs for growth. So A is your right answer. Which human feature shows discontinuous variation? What is the discontinuous variation that has only which is only very low types? The blood group is a type of discontinuous variation. A blood group can only be A, B, O, or it can be blood group AB. So AB, which can be a variation which can be measured easily, are called discontinuous variation. They are easy to be distinguished. So agility, mental agility, is a continuous feature which cannot be easily distinguished. Body height is again highly varying variation, so it is again incorrect. Obesity, again, someone has a weight of 30 kg, 35, 40, aged people have 70, 75. So obesity is again a continuous variation. With a sickle cell anemia, which is rare to be found but is transferred in genes, is a discontinuous variation. So D is your right option. MCQ. Albinism is an inherited condition caused by a recessive allele. The first thing is that albinism is caused by a recessive allele. I call it AA. And the diagram shows a tree family for a family affected by this condition. So individuals 9 and 11, which are shown in shaded, have albinism. What is the chance that individual 10 is heterozygous? Now, he has asked us to calculate the possible chances by which this individual 10 would be heterozygous. Now, first of all, we can see that 3 and 4 mate together to produce 3 organisms, among which one is an albino. It means that both of them will have a recessive gene. Both of them will have a recessive gene. And they produce one albino AA, and they produce two organisms with normal body pigmentation. So means that they will also have an A capital gene. They will also have a capital gene. So that means 3 and 4 are heterozygous first of all. Now in 1 and 2 we can see that 1 and 2 both produce 1 and 2 both produce 3 organisms which are of normal body pigmentation. But when one of their child 7 combines with the 3-4 family, this family, it produces an albino again. So there is an AA here. What does this mean? That this 7 is also has a small a gene here. This also has a small a gene. So now I have to find chances in which this individual 10 is heterozygous. Now, if I check once again, I have to find possible combinations of 3 and 4. So AA, so this is 3, this is 4, so it will give us 1 AA, it will give us small AA, and it will give us 2 heterozygous, 2 homozygous, 2 heterozygous. So I can see that the chances of 10 being a heterozygous are not 3 in 4, it is 2 in 4. It is 2 in 4, I guess. So 2 are heterozygous here, 2 are heterozygous, and 2 are homozygous. 2 are heterozygous and 2 are homozygous. Now, what I can infer once again, that the chances of 10 being a heterozygous are 2 in 4, I guess. If there are 4 organisms of 3 and 4, then among them 2 are definitely heterozygous. Now, I have been given that one of them is an albino, so we are left with 3. So 2 by 3 makes sense. 2 by 3 makes sense that if he has 3, that if 3 and 4, this family has organisms with genetic combination which contains a capital A gene, then these 3 organisms, among them 2 would be heterozygous and 1 would be homozygous. So this is a tricky MCQ. So I would go with C. So C is your right option. The number of weed plants was counted at monthly intervals. The table shows the results. So I think I have to revise the concept for 38 again. So these 3 and 4 both are heterozygous, as I had said, and these heterozygous produce one homozygote albino, and they produce two heterozygote normal body pigmentation organisms, and then they would have had, if there was a fourth organism, it would have been a homozygote with normal body pigmentation, a male or a female, whatever it is. So the chances of individual 10 in is being a heterozygote is 2 in 4 actually, but now there is one albino. Now there is one albino, so now the chances become 4 minus 1, that is 3. So 2 by 3 are now the chances for 10 being an albino, of 10 being a heterozygote. So so C is your right answer. And one thing I had forgot to say, that 8 is definitely a heterozygote, and 7 can be, and 7 is again a heterozygote. So A is your right option. So if 8 is, so C is your right option, 8 is a heterozygote. Similarly, 10 would be a heterozygote. AA, if there was a fourth organism, it would have been a homozygote with normal body pigmentation. And 9 is the albino with homozygote combination. So the chances are 2 in 4, 2 heterozygote in 4 organisms. But now there is 1 albino, so the chances reduced by 1. So there are chances of 2 by 3. So C is your right answer, not 3 in 4, 0 in 4, again incorrect. B is incorrect. D is your right answer. The number of weed plants in a grass field was counted at monthly intervals. The table showed the results. So since August 2020, the field was mown regularly and used as a football pitch. So the ground, so the field has now been destructed. From this information, which two weeds are best adapted to survive in the mown grass? So the number of plants which have survived are, the ground cell has reduced significantly, the dock has again reduced significantly, the plantain plant has the greatest capability to survive the mowing, so it is greatly adapted, whereas dandelion is again greatly adapted. So plantain and dandelion are greatly adapted to the environment. They can survive if the field is mown regularly. So C is your right option. Last MCQ, question number 40. So finally our paper comes to an end. Human insulin genes can be inserted into the bacteria. The bacteria can be cultured and will produce human insulin as a byproduct. What is an advantage to a patient advantage to a patient of using this source of insulin rather than insulin from animals. It can be used to prevent the development of diabetes. It can be used to prevent the dangerous effects. It can be used to control diabetes, not developing diabetes. So A is incorrect. It will allow the pancreas to regenerate. No, it will not allow them. It has no relation with the regeneration of pancreas. The insulin from animals has fewer side effects. No, it has greater side effects because it is not GMO. It is much cheaper to produce. This is the greatest, the best possible advantage to a person who is middle class or a patient who is middle class which cannot afford the costly insulin extracted from animals. So D is your right answer. So that's all for our today's video. Make sure to like and subscribe. Hope you have got the concepts clearly, and press the bell icon for upcoming videos and past papers. Allah Hafiz.